Dr. Haney. This is my first engagement with the Economic Society. I didn't know about it until I heard from Dr. Haney, so I am very pleased to join this distinguished group of scholars. I see the topic that you are going to talk about today, and I thought that I might be able to just give you a brief about a background paper for this topic. This paper entitled Bread Justice, Bread Dignity, or Opportunity, the Determinants of the Arab Awakening. This is the title that's been published in the World Development last year, 2015. So this paper by the title Bread Justice or Opportunity, the Determinants of the Arab Awakening, is co-authored with a couple of colleagues from Ohio State University, and one of our graduates there who is now at Nebraska, Professor Greg Jenkins, is my co-author along with Matthew Castello, which this was basically his main job market paper, so to speak. The topic is very dear to me. I was looking around when the Arab Spring happened. I happened to be in Egypt at that time, so I have actually lived it in Egypt, and I moved to Tunisia also in the same months. So I have been around the Arab Spring in person for 2011 and 2012, and I have seen what happened, and I just kept reading about the bread and the social justice slogan. And there was a lot of writings in the media, a lot of writings, and also articles scientifically and the like that try to basically figure out what happened, what was going on. The idea here behind this paper is very simple. We wanted to see what are the determinants. What are the factors that really determine the Arab Spring? Why the Arab Spring happened? The two competing theory came from the different fields, the political science in one end, and of course economics from the other. Needless to say that all of the social science has been involved in terms of sociology, demography, media and communication, and so on and so forth. All of these were competing factors, and nobody knew exactly what was the major culprit. Some people said definitely the bread, the economic issues. Others mentioned that no, it's the Twitter and Facebook revolution. It's the new media revolution. Definitely the youth bulge or the demography was another culprit that has been stated in some of the writing quite a bit. In addition, of course, to the political climate, the repression and the terrors and so on. So we tried to basically figure out exactly what happened. This is a very good example of interdisciplinary research. We built on theories from political science and sociology in order to figure out what happened. The problem with this kind of research that we really don't have data. So being endowed with research assistant, we got a couple of young scholars in order basically to create a data set for us. I think this is a major contribution of the paper. We used these two young scholars in order to code basically from news pieces, mainly from Reuters, all the news stories that has to do with revolt, protest, and so on. The idea is to accumulate, in this case, for 18 countries, Arab countries, and Arab countries meant here the majority of the population are Arab. We accumulated data for Algeria, Bahrain, Egypt, Jordan, Kuwait, Iraq, Lebanon, Libya, and Syria, Tunisia, Saudi Arabia, Mauritania, Morocco, Oman, United Arab Emirates, Sudan, and Yemen. All of these, we went to the news stories, and we, whenever there is a story about protest, about demonstration, we used around 45 keywords, actually, that has to do with strikes, marches, picketing, everything that basically fall in the realm of riots. We have collected this data for these countries from 2006 to 2011 on an annual basis, and we try to differentiate between peaceful protest, non-violent, and violent protest. So that's what happened. We were very grateful for these two folks who brought to us this data. There was a lot of scrutiny afterward in order to see how they collected the data. We actually went on around in order to see if the data collected is the one that reflected the news story or not. So we have a reviewer involved on this. We got very lucky with the work of these two individuals. And we have basically find out that this is going to be our dependent variable. So the count of basically data that talked about protesting is used by this paper as a dependent variable. As account data, this meant that we have to do a little bit of work in order to overcome the shortcoming of the count data that basically comes in the form of wide dispersion. So we used a method econometrically to deal with that. On the other hand, we have also collected data for the independent variable that reflected the stories of these competing theories, whether it is the economic factors. So we collected data basically for the variable that reflect that, and we used, in this case, consumer price index. We used mineral rent over GDP, the data collected by the World Bank, in addition to the child mortality rate that reflect the basically standard of living in the countries. We have experimented with quite a bit of data. Unfortunately, most of the straightforward direct variable were not available, like unemployment data, especially for the youth and the like. We also created a variable for the youth bulge, the adult population between the age of 15 to 29. We used the United Nations data for that. And for the political theory, we used some of the indicators that is well known, like the political opponents. This is the one of the factors that's collected and indexed by the Freedom House, which basically express the political right and civil liberty. And on the other side, we had political terror, the level of physical rights violation. Also, this was indexed. And we tried also to see if the type of ruling in the country, whether it's a republic or monarch, has anything to do with that. In terms of the media issues, we have used the cell phone penetration in the country. Cell phone and internet seems to be quite correlated, so we use the cell phone since this is much more indicative in the case of Egypt in particular. The political terror has also been captured by coercive policing, which is a variable that we also collected during this active Reuters Newswire exercise. In this case, we have also tried to figure out what we call the sibling effect, the diffusion of this unrest, by taking Egypt and Tunisia counts and make them a control variable in this equation or in these models that we have built. The models that we have built has used basically the binomial model, and what we have done is quite a bit of a battery of tests in order to make sure that our variables in terms of data collection and in terms of control of the model itself are online. There is a data being collected in Africa, it's called the SCAD, Social Conflict in Africa database, being published in 2012. And we try to compare our data with them. And because they are only confined to the country in Asia, I'm sorry, in Africa, ours was quite correlated with this database, even though we have annual protest count that were consistently higher, given that we have the other countries in Asia as well. Just to give you a brief about the result and why I'm using this paper here as the one that I I'm going to basically deduce some result from that might help in the current condition. We find out basically from the result of the three models that we have used, one that only focus on the economic argument, we called it the bread argument, and the other one that focus on the political argument, we call it the justice, and then another model that has the combined both argument. What happened there, we have used it for both violent and non-violent count of data. And it was very interesting. Here is the major results. This control variable for Egypt and Tunisia non-violent counts significant all the way in every model. It's also significant for the violent model, which means that Egypt and Tunisia count basically acted as diffusion. Tunisia as the first event that happened, and basically people looked at Tunisia as a leader in this case, and Egypt because of the historical, as you know, impact of the country culturally and the like on the rest of the Arab world. So it was very interesting to find this sibling rivalry, as we try to explain it, to be very much significant. On the other side, we did not find significant result for the youth bulge. And probably if we have used youth unemployment, it would have been much better in this case. Let me also say that we used the consumer price index, the child mortality, and the RAS variable here that he has used, and this is Michael RAS, famous mineral and rent variables. What happened there, we find out that these are significant when we have the simple bread equation, and they were not significant in the combined model. when we use the political model or the justice model, as we say, political terror is quite significant. Political openness was also significant, and the coercive policing is significant, both in the simple model and in the combined model. Just to make sure that I'm reporting the exact result, we have differentiated, as I mentioned, between the violent protest and the non-violent protest, and we very much found a very the same result happen in both sides. To make this a bit clear and to the point, the opponent's argument is a bit different from the political terror argument, as you know. So the opponent's argument means that as the country gives more rights, political and citizen rights, there will be more protest. That's what this says. And also the terror one is the same. Usually they should go in opposite direction, but in our model they went simultaneously, which give us some way to think that maybe if the country is repressive and just open the door a little bit, the dissident will respond to both the intense grievance flowing from the threat part and the perception that their action are likely to succeed because of the openings, and there will be more count of protest in this case. The Arab Awakening were largely driven from our model, as we have seen it, by the political grievance. This is the one that drove the majority of these protests. Political terror basically is one that apparently the strongest predictor, and that, as I just mentioned, and it's also been the case whether for the violent or non-violent protest. It's correctly described that the Arab state, among the most repressive regime in the Arab world, in the world as a whole, under human rights record, has been gagged by political arrest, political torture, arbitrary imprisonment, and all of the other factor. So it's no wonder why this is the case over here. It's very interesting to also note that in many respects, the economic factors, even though they are significant in their own, but they were not significant in the combined, which means that the political aspect is more more of a factor. The deficiency of the democracy is significant and positive. The state terror is significant and positive, and this will give us actually some thinking that for the time being, by the way, the cell phone also, we found it to be significant, and the media overall seemed to play a role in the spread of the protest. But for the time being, and as we see from the current state of affairs, whether in Egypt or Tunisia, as the two major countries that have witnessed the Arab Awakening, that solving the economic problem does require solving the political problem, and vice versa. So we actually end our paper saying that this is a vicious circle. It remains a major challenge for these states to basically resolve these two issues at the same time. So drawing on what is going on right now, we find out that just floating the currency in Egypt or getting a successful fund in Tunisia from the IMF or the African Development Bank is not going to resolve the issue. I think more of openness in terms of the political system should work hand in hand with all of the efforts that's been basically going on right now in order to basically put the country back on the correct path to transition to the state of affairs that we are all hoping this country will be in. I'm trying to basically put it as clear and in the time that is allotted, and all of the factors that we have put over here, as I said, you can read it in full in the paper that is published in the World Development Journal in volume 67 last year, 2015. And I'll be more than happy to entertain questions if you guys would allow me to do so.